We're going to talk about why and what we did in the project, the outputs and some implications. So first up to the why. So we really need to be able to get the most effective surveillance coverage to enable, everyone talks about early detection of incursions, but I suppose what we really want is timely detection because it depends on the taxa involved. And to look for synergies between the approaches, I think is an emergent thing from the project. So if we just look at the a bit of a schema of how we went about prioritisation, you've got the set of high-risk introduction locations, and then overlapping that, you've got a set of suitable habitat for actual establishment. And then lastly, you've got the set where citizen surveillance is actually not being effective. So there's always this desire to sensorise, put surveillance everywhere, but we really need to prioritise where we do surveillance because we do have limited resources. So this idea that there's this area where citizens are not covering that we can target our active surveillance. Okay, so what we did, we took a case study approach to citizen detections of exotic vertebrates. We undertook analysis of sightings by citizens uploading to the online platforms such as iNaturalist and eBird. We critiqued the value to bring modern analytic tools, it's data mining to show social media feeds, and I should note I did that with Phil Cassie. We described the components of citizen science and we developed some methods for actually analysing citizen science type activity because it doesn't actually fit within the standard scientific approach. Developed remote acoustic detection devices for starlings, and there'll be a talk delivered by Pete Adams on behalf of Susan Campbell coming up, depending on which run sheet you're using. And Steve Shures is in Queensland, developed audio trapping devices in collaboration with collaborators in Indonesia for detecting Asian black spine toads. Outputs, just quickly, a lot of knowledge of how citizen science actually operates at the taxonomic group level, which groups do they detect well, which do they not, how it applies in space and time. I talked about the methods for analysis. There's surveillance of starlings that we talked about, and the risk analysis for the black spine toads. So a bit more detail. So incursion risks now and then. So this hinges off some of Phil's work. So historically, most incursions of vertebrates were deliberate, and they're actually instigated by acclimatisation societies, private individuals, governments, for heaven's sake. But times have changed. There's not going to be a lot of deliberate releases. So future incursions, they're going to arise mainly from escapes and releases from captivity. I don't want to keep my pet whatever it is anymore. I'm going to let it go. It's mainly pet owners, enthusiasts, and zoos as well. It's going to change. It's going to be fewer, if any, mammals, although Phil did note some of the ones that are becoming popular in the mammal line. And there'll be more reptiles and fish, plus a few species such as the black spine toad, which is a quite effective hitchhiker. And so the key thing here is citizens are actually they're central to the problem of new incursions. So it sort of makes sense that citizens as observers are ideally placed to be part of the solution. So citizen crowdsourcing of species identification is powerful. The project found it's really quite high sensitivity. And within it, you see this emergence of self-organising online, what we call communities of practice. There's dedicated platforms to this that I've already mentioned. There's social media groups galore on Facebook, and there's groups on Instagram. And just some examples from Facebook. I just want to stick on the Snake Identification Australia. It's got 72,000 members. It's got at least 50 posts a day. Its explicit purpose is snake species identification, education, and wildlife advocacy. So if it's trying to get fast identification to educate people about snakes in their houses, in their yards, it's a go-to place that functions as an amazing resource for people who are seeing things in the world around them. So a couple of good news stories, just to back up my point. If we, sometime in the noughties, four Canada geese arrived in a remote wetland in southern New South Wales, promptly detected by amateur bird watchers who actually managed to track them as they moved amongst the swamps across southern south coast until authorities effectively removed them. More recently, in Oran Park, Western Sydney, this neighbour noticed this this snake hanging off the garage. They posted it to their snake identification Facebook group. People quickly said, I think this is a boa, it's an imported boa. And a snake catcher was called, authorities were notified, the poor snake was impounded within hours. But there's gaps. So, and these include creatures of the night. So nocturnal photography is hard, and images are a central component of sharing and crowdsourcing identifications. Aquatic environments, again, it's really hard to get photos. It's an expensive camera to go underwater. It's hard to get access to aquatic environments in general. So thinking about the active targeted continuum, it's a really important role here for EDNA, especially for invasive fish, which Dial talk about. Inaccessible environments, so there's areas where the public can't get, such as around, around ports or just restricted public access. So there's a role for targeted or active agency activity in such areas with poor accessibility. And there's other areas that are remote, though important, and a good example is the West Australian, South Australian border with respect to starlings, where there's another role for agencies' active activity. So I think the next slide actually just looks at that. Oh, no. So what I want to talk about now is this idea that, hey, maybe we can get more if we apply modern data mining techniques to social media streams. Can we get, is it cheap, a way to get highly sensitive surveillance data? So I did this work with Phil Cassie, and we came to an interesting finding that it's really unlikely to be much improvement on existing citizen reporting. And the other thing was it won't be easy nor cheap, which was actually a big part of the justification for going down the analytic route. And part of the reason for that, there's a lot of species to consider. We've got tens of thousands, so it's a very big, got a 3-minute call, a big image classification problem, and there's a lot of noise in social media feeds, which makes natural language processing to detect the sentiment that I've discovered something that could be exotic hard to actually pick up. So we thought human-centered approaches seem much more preferable around increasing awareness, around making taxonomic tools more readily available for people to make their own identifications and realise when they need to report authorities. For example, here's the poor old boa, South American boa in Parada. Here's a picture that turned up on Facebook 2 days after the impoundment. If you put that through the iNaturalist classifier, it gets pretty close. It says, I think this is a boa of some species. So that's really good. But the point is that the citizen surveillance system had already had this creature locked up. Job was done. Okay, just quickly, here's a heat map of the intensity of bird reports across Australia, overlaid with the last 5 years with the distribution of starling reports from eBird and BirdLife Australia, and just highlighting there's a big chunk along the West Australian, South Australian border where there's one of the few places where there's very little citizen surveillance and we need to do something else, and that's Susan's work. Okay, got to get back, will this work? And related to that, this is the work of Steve Shires about sentinel trap deployment for Asian buck spine toad with traps in high-risk locations in the islands, Torres Strait, Mackay, and down around Brisbane, including Oxley Wetlands, which is a container break area where they're actually using the local people, land care groups, to help check these traps. So implications, that's one, is it? Okay, citizen surveillance is well targeted. It relies on citizens being interested in the world around them and knowing who to contact when they see something out of line. False positives are actually expensive, so raising awareness comes at a cost unless you put the effort into education. It's got a big role. Last slide. So I think, you know, Australia's best defence against future invasions of vertebrate pests involves the eyes, ears, knowledge, cameras, phones of its citizens in combination with targeted surveillance, where citizen surveillance is inadequate. Thank you.